Hey there, Magic Geeks! In this video, we will learn how to configure your GA4 property. So let's dive into it. So you implemented your GA4 snippet on your website and you can see some data flowing into your property. Okay, you might be even measuring some events, but you must always make sure that everything is set up correctly. And this is step number one when you create a new property, because it's like a musical instrument or a machine. In order to play the instrument and or to operate the machine, you must make sure they are set up correctly first. And the same with GA4, because we want to get the best possible results. We want to get the accurate data. And this is why the first thing you must do is to ensure that everything is set up in the correct way. Okay, so let's have a look at our GA4 account. And you can see the account architecture. On the left side, we have everything related to the account settings, whereas on the right side, we have everything related to the property. And here we have the account settings. This is where you can find your account name, the country of business, and you can also see some data sharing settings. So let's say you want to provide access to some Google technicians, then you would have to mark this one. Or if you want to give access to account specialists, for example, sales representatives, in this case, you would have to select this one and you can save your changes. Okay, and then we also have account access management. And this is fundamental because you must understand who is managing your account, who has access to your properties. And this is where you can do it. And let's say you want to invite a team of marketers to work on your project. And this is where you can do it by adding user groups. Or let's say you want to add some individual users. And this is where you can also do it. And you would have to assign a role to a user. And the cool thing about GA4 is that now you can also hide cost and revenue related metrics. Let's say you have a new intern and you don't want to show this data. And you can simply hide it by marking those options. Okay, I will not save that. We also have filters here, but we can ignore this one because it's related to universal analytics only. We also have account change history, and this is exactly where you can check what changes were made. And this is good to know. And a rubbish bin. So you can simply delete your account if you do not need it anymore. And this was a quick overview of account settings. And now let's move to the most exciting part, and these are property settings. Here we have the property name, industry category, and it has an impact on your reports. Let's say I want to have games, and let me show you what will happen. So now if I go to my reports, GA4 will adjust the reporting interface to the industry you select. So you can see here we have games reporting, and GA4 will also show you suggested audiences related to the industry that you selected. But let's go back, and I want to have my other category back. Let me change it. I would say other. Another crucial thing you must always double check is the reporting time zone. So usually this is the time zone of a place where your business is headquartered, but you might have a different case. But this also has a direct impact on the data shown in your reports. And this is why you must double check that, as well as currency. Okay, so let's save this one and let's move to our property access management. And this is why you should be very careful, because some people by mistake might add a user at an account level. Yeah, because we have account access and property access. And this is why you should always double check if everything is managed in a correct way and all users have their correct roles assigned. Then we have data settings. And there is something called data collection. And this is where you can activate Google Signals. And it is very important to understand the impact it might have on your data. So before enabling this feature, You must always make sure that you have read the privacy policy, that you understand all the data restrictions, data regulations in your location. And another thing you should keep in mind is that you are ready to face some thresholding. And Charles Farina wrote a great tweet, I guess. There was a tweet, not an article, explaining this issue. So sometimes if you have some conversions and they don't have great numbers, maybe because it might be a small customers, analytics might be hiding them, not showing them to you in order to kind of protect your users so that you cannot identify those with the help of some demographical user features. This is why you must make sure that you're ready to face this kind of issue. Then we have something called data retention. And this is another setting you should pay attention to. Because when you create a new property, the data retention is by default 2 months. And you should change it to 14 months. Again, if there are no restrictions, if you discuss this with your legal department, I would say. But this has an impact on your explorations. So this setting would not influence your aggregated data anyhow, but everything that is associated with cookies, user identifiers, or advertising identifiers will not be available after 2 months. And let's say you want to make an analysis going back in time. And unfortunately, this will not be possible beyond standard reports. So this is why you should also double check this one. Now let me save this one. Another important setting is data filters. They're kind of limited now in GA4 comparing to universal analytics, and there is not much we could do here. So you can see we have internal traffic, so you don't want to have polluted reports and you want to exclude yourself and your colleagues. And this is how you can do it. There is not much we can actually do. You can also see filter states. We have testing, active and inactive. Why do we have testing? Yeah, because GA4 gives us a possibility to test the filter we created as they are not retroactive. And you can see that we have testing, active and inactive. And this is pretty much it. And also, if you want to exclude your internal traffic, you must all define it. So one more step to be made. You should go to data streams, and here we can find configure tag settings, show all, and this is where you can define your internal traffic. And let's have a look. As an example, I have my home office, and then you provide the IP address, and this is how analytics would understand, okay, there is a parameter, internal traffic type internal, and I should exclude this guy or girl because I don't want to have polluted reports. Okay, let's go back to our settings. And another crucial thing is just to make sure that you linked your GA4 property to other tools. And the most common are Google Ads, Search Console, BigQuery, and Merchant Center. But it fully depends on your case and you might be using different tools, but you just make sure that you connected everything, and linking is pretty straightforward. So you just simply click link and then you will choose your Google account. Okay, so those were some basic settings you should check, but I would also love to cover some settings that can be customized in a way. So something that you can choose for your specific case. And the first one is unwanted referrals. So let's say you have an e-commerce store. And let me just go to the demo account because there is some data here. And if you go to acquisition, traffic acquisition, and here we have session source medium. And this is where you can see your referrals. And let's say if you see something like PayPal or Klarna here, this is not a good sign. So you want to exclude those unwanted guests. And this is where you can do. We should go to data streams, and here you can configure tag settings. And this is where you can list unwanted referrals. Yeah, so you simply provide the conditions and you say, I don't want to see them in my reports because they pollute my data, right? So you should not see those payment gateways. Yeah, for example, paypal.com or klarna.com. Okay, another thing I would love to show that should be checked is the reporting identity. And here you can see we have different ways to identify your users. We have blended, observed, and device-based. So in good old universal analytics, we had something called client ID, and this was basically device ID. So you could also implement user ID in universal analytics, but you would also have to create a separate view for that. So you would not have this holistic picture of your user journey. And now in GA4, we have cross-device tracking. And here you can see in the blended type, we have user ID as primary identifier. So if you have some logging functionality or some way to identify your users, if you have this feature implemented, so GA4 would use this one. If it's not available, it would fall back on Google Signals and would use that as an identifier. We already discussed that. So you should always consider advantages and disadvantages of enabling this feature. And if Google Signals are not available, the device ID or the former client ID will be used. And then we also have something called modeling, model data. And this is a beta feature. So you know that Google has been heavily investing in machine learning, and we're really curious to see how this will be developing. And we also have something called attribution settings. This is also a new cool thing available in GA4. Now you can also select an attribution model, just so that we are all on the same page. What is an attribution model? Let's say you're running multiple ads and your user clicks on one ad, then second ad, then third ad, and then converts, makes a purchase, for example. But how can you identify which ad click contributed to that conversion? And there are different ways to do it. So you can select last click, for example, and all the credit would go to the last click ad. By default here, we can see the data-driven model, but you can play with it. And the cool thing is that it will apply to both historical and future data. So feel free to discover. Whereas you should be very careful with the look back window settings because they are not retroactive. So this will only apply going forward. And here you can see we have the acquisition conversion events, 30 days recommended on all other conversion events, 90 days recommended. And you can also play with that. And what is the look back window? So a user clicks on your ad and then it might take some time for that user to convert, especially if this is some very expensive product. It makes sense. This person needs some time. But later, this can be counted as a conversion and you select this time period for user to convert. So you can leave the settings as you want or you can play with those. So these are the main settings you should check when you create your new property. To sum up, the main GA4 property settings in a nutshell are account naming, user management, data retention, Google Signals, filters, and account linking. And you can also customize some settings, such as attribution model, listing unwanted referrals, and your reporting identity. If you like this video, please give us a thumbs up, and you can check other GA4 videos right here. And happy measuring, guys. See you next time.